Okay. Do you want to add something? No. Bollinger Bands. So this is the only indicator personally I'm using, and it's my favorite. So this guy is Stan Weinstein, and I recommend you to read his book. You have it here, Secret of blah, blah, blah. So this guy, he invented a theory, and you remember I told you don't listen to guys who invented theory, but his theory is what he's using for me, it's a bit stupid, but the idea behind the theory is great. And we can see after that we can prove that this theory kind of work. So I just wanted to give him credits, even if I don't recommend to use his theory. But just to let you know, for the one who wants to read his book, according to him, stock markets, it was 40 years ago, works in four phases. So you have the accumulation phases, where people doesn't really know. So here, the crowd, so basically the people, they don't buy, they don't sell. They don't have information, they don't know these stocks. But there is people who are in the know, so maybe bank or people inside a company that have information, and they maybe know that, as example, there will be a good result. And so if there is a good result, maybe the people will buy the stocks. So they start to buy here. So it's what we call accumulation. Then we have the phase number two. So the phase number two, it's when the movement starts to go from basically a range, so the phase number one, to a trend. And here, it's only the people who are the fastest, so other bank or this kind of thing, or hedge funds who enter in the market. Then you have the phase number three, it's when you enter in the market. So it's when your banker call you and say, hey, listen, I have a great opportunity. I don't know if it happened in Bulgaria, but in France it happened. Sometimes your banker calls you and tells you, hey, I have a great opportunity, you should put your money there, and they call you here. And why they call you here, not that there is a conspiracy theory, but it's because the people who bought there, they have to sell. They have to sell to someone. So to who they have to sell, they have to sell to you. Because we are always the stupid who are buying there, but what we buy to let people who enter here sell. And so he calls the phase number three, I think, the slowdown or something like that. And after what happened, there is a phase number four, it's when the market crash. Because all the people who bought here, so let's say that this is Bitcoin, so at 20,000, all the people who bought there, they start to panic because it doesn't go up. And when you panic, what you do? You sell. And when you sell, what happens? It goes down. So it's how he represents markets. So it doesn't apply to modern markets because it doesn't work anymore, this kind of thing. I mean, I speak about this like 20 or 50 years ago. But just to let you know, my first experience with financial market, actually, it's really this. It's a banker who called my parents maybe 2 months before the end of the bubble, internet bubble in 2001. And he called them and said, put all your money on the stock market. They are stupid, so they did it. And they became broke. So, Bollinger Band. You have to see the market only in a binary vision. Either the market has no trend, either the market has a trend. That's all. This it's the volume per price, because usually when you have no trend, you have big volume in the middle and few volume on the top. And when you have an uptrend, you have a volume that looks like that. But I just forget to remove this. It was not supposed to be there. So, let's say that when you have no trends, you are in the phase number one. So like Weinstein, it's where there is accumulation of volume. And we see it. There is a very big accumulation of people buying, selling, buying, selling. So here, people are waiting. They don't really know what happened. Then you have the trend that we can cut into four different parts. So the phase number two, it's the explosion. The phase number three, acceleration. The phase number three, it's more linear. So here you see you have a very big movement. And then here you have a movement which is a bit slowing down. It keeps going up, but not that much. And then you have the phase number four, it's when it's really a slowing down and you have the deceleration. So markets, modern markets, work this way. You always have the four phases. So let me introduce you this guy, Bollinger. So he's a guy who wrote a book and he invented an indicator called Bollinger Band. And the Bollinger Band uses standard deviation. So what is standard deviation? Let's say that this is when you take your car, you go to Varna and you take the highway. So of course you don't drive every time at the same speed. When you start in the highway, you drive kind of slow. Then when you are in the middle of the highway, you drive kind of fast. And then when you arrive in Varna, you slow down. So let's say that this is the evolution of your speed. This is a moving average, the one that we have explained you before. So basically it shows what is your your speed average for the whole trip. So as you can see, sometimes it's upper, lower, blah, blah. Those lines are the distance between your speed and your moving average. So example, when you are here, we can say that for the past 5 hours, your speed average was 100 kilometer, but at the moment you drive at 130 kilometer. Okay? So the distance between your current speed and your average speed, there is no name, it's just the distance, the difference. When you take all those difference and you decide to make an average of this difference, so you make, try to follow, you make the average of the distance between your speed and the average speed, and you end up to have something called standard deviation. Maybe it reminds you some mathematics lesson for the youngest among us. So standard deviation is just this. It's the average deviation between your current speed and your average speed. Everybody understood this? Okay. How we build Bollinger Band, then we take the moving average, and we're gonna add plus one standard deviation, so this, and minus one. And we're gonna do it two times, actually. So it's plus two moving, plus two standard deviation and minus two. Why this guy has decided to use two times the standard deviation? If you remember your mathematics lesson, what is the mathematical property of one standard deviation? Steffi? Okay, someone knows what is the mathematical property of one standard deviation? No, it doesn't remind you anything? Okay, so as your literature before, okay. So, but this is a second grade. I mean, okay. So, so to remember you, the moving average. Let's say we are in a class. Okay, so the average note, we take all your notes and we divide it by the number of students. Let's say we have 14. The median, it's 50% of the people above. And when you make one standard deviation, it means that 60% of the people are between plus one and minus one standard deviation. So it means that if we have 20 students, the average note is 14, and the standard deviation is, let's say, two, it means that 60% of the students, they have between 16 and 12. And so 40% are, of course, below. And when you have two standard deviation, it's 95%. So if one standard deviation was two, two standard deviation is four. So 95% of the students had between 18 and 10. And so 5% of the students, either they have below 10 or below 18. So this guy, Bollinger, he was like, okay, so if we apply this to market, it means that these points, 95% of the price are below, are between those 2 points, and 5% of the price are above those points. So he wanted to represent the price that are above the two standard deviation as the extreme price of this kind of thing. I really don't like this theory because for me it's totally stupid, but it was to explain you the idea behind the Bollinger Band. So how we can make the Bollinger Band? So you have the price, range, and trends. So phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four. Okay. So then we're gonna use the standard deviation. Okay. When the trend is flat, the standard deviation is flat also. It's logic. Remember, what is the standard deviation? It's the average of the distance between the price and its moving average. as you can see, you have almost always the same distance. It's logic when you have a range, of course, the moving price of the range, it's mostly in the middle, and the price just evolve around the middle. So the standard deviation in a range mostly always look like that. Then when you have the price that goes, that accelerates, you have the price which goes far from its average, so the standard deviation increase. Then when the price, when the moving average and the price start to get closer, the standard deviation, as you see, start to make this shape. And then when the price totally slow down, then the moving the standard deviation does this. And by magic, we can see we have four phases. The standard deviation is flat, phase one. The standard deviation increase, phase two. The standard deviation slow down, phase three. The standard deviation go back to initial point, phase four. And you see the evolution of the market. So how we make the Bollinger Bands? So as we said, we just applied moving average plus the standard deviation, and moving average minus the standard deviation. So you end up to have an indicator which looks like that. So you can recognize a bit the shape of the standard deviation. You see, you have this kind of bubble. So the Bollinger Band, as you can see, they are drawing channel. So here you can identify the square. Here you can identify the channel. And here again, you can identify the square. But there is another thing that the Bollinger Band shows you. It's the orientation of the bands. So in a phase one, most of the time, your Bollinger Band will have this shape. So it will be like a square. In phase two, the two Bollinger Bands are opposites. So one going up and one going down. On the phase three, the two Bollinger Bands are parallel. And on phase four, the two Bollinger Bands are going in the same direction. Just remember this pattern and that's all. So how it looks like? This is a chart of I don't know what. And as weird as it sounds, we're going to start actually at the end, because again, we are here to try to analyze markets. So we start at the very end. When you look at a chart, you look at moving, look at Bollinger Band, and what you have to spot, so here the camera is maybe too close. We try to spot when the moving average start to phase number four. So phase number four, if you remember, it's here. So what is the phase number four? It's when the two Bollinger Band start to go in the same direction, okay? So the Bollinger Band was going up, it goes down. So here, the Bollinger Band was going down, and now it goes up, okay? So this, it's the start of the phase four. When you have the start of the phase four, so of course you don't know what can happen on the right, huh? So let's say that it didn't happen. What you have to do, it's something super easy. You take the last bottom, and you take the last top. And you just do that. That's all. So remember, this doesn't exist. You have the phase four, bottom, top, and if you remember what is the phase four, it was the movement start to slow down. So when you know that the movement start to slow down based on your indicator, you try to put a frame and you say, until the price doesn't break one of this level, there is a huge probability that there will be absolutely no movement. So until one of these two lines is broken, you can't be sure, but you have a big probability that the movement will basically be a range after that. And it's what happened actually after. Here, you can see something also important. It's the distance between the Bollinger Band was big and start to be smaller. When the Bollinger Band start to be smaller, it means that the volatility starts to decrease. So what I like to do, I try to move my lines, because this was the initial line that I drawn when we were here. But now I have more information. I know that now the markets start to be more compressed. And if you remember what is two standard deviations, so This is plus 2 standard deviation, minus 2 standard deviation. If you remember what I said about the mathematics lesson, 95% of the data are between those two lines. So when I have the Bollinger Band here and here, I know that 95% of the price are between those two lines. So basically it means that my range, I will just try to connect my line to the closest top of the Bollinger Band and this one to the closest low of my Bollinger Band, and I can adjust or update my range. And after, I just need to wait this range to be broken to say I have a new trend. And this is how I spot or I try to anticipate range and how I will analyze a new trend happening. Another example here. So here you see it's more complicated to spot, but you have, because it's not always easy, you have the phase number 4, so you have the Bollinger Band going down, which start to go up, so phase 4. So reflex, we draw here the lowest and there the highest. And as you see again here, it works super good. So it means that just here, we could anticipate, I mean, almost, what will happen after. And then of course, when you have more information, when the Bollinger Band start to be parallel, because here, basically, the Bollinger Band start to be parallel, you know that you have your phase 1, and when you have the break of this phase 1, then you know that you have a new trend. Then again, here you have the phase 4, the lowest point, the highest point, and as you see again, it works super good after you have a range, then you adapt the range to the Bollinger Band, so you have what we call a squeeze, and then here you know that you have a new trend which is happening. That's all. Do you have questions about it or was it clear? The only things you have to know is to try to recognize the phase 4. You put the top, you put the bottom, you wait, and as you can see, it works pretty good because here it's only there that we have the information, so we don't know what happened after. And after, you just adjust your support and your resistance to the Bollinger Band. No question? Very good question. So it's forbidden to trade in phase 1. It's forbidden to trade in phase 3. It's forbidden to trade in phase 4. So you have to enter in the phase 2. You have to enter at the beginning of a movement. But this we're going to speak about it next week. Other tips that the Bollinger Band can be super helpful, it can shows you that the movement that will happen will be an explosive movement, or the movement that will happen will be a linear movement. And as example, as you can see here, you had a phase 1, and then you have a big explosion. So how we see the explosion, of course, you have big candle, but the Bollinger Band, which is opposite to the movement, is going very, very strongly down. So when you have this, you know that the movement has a lot of chance to be an explosion. When you have an explosion in a movement, it means that suddenly a lot of people start to buy a lot of volume and they want to sell super, super quick. It means that they buy here and they want to find a way to sell. Usually, when they start to sell, it will be here. And what is happening, we enter in the phase 3. So remember, don't try to mix up the phase. The phase 4, I will re-put it here, pop. The phase 4, it's at the end, okay, when the two Bollinger Band goes in the same direction. The phase 3, it's when the Bollinger Band were opposed in phase 2, and now they start to be parallel, so they are in the same direction. So here, phase 1, phase 2, phase 3, and the phase 4 we don't see, but it's there. And as you can see, when you have an explosive movement, what is happening right after the phase 3 starts, end of the movement? Again, it's just an indicator, so it doesn't mean that it shows the future or whatever. No, it just shows indication. So what the indicator shows you here, it shows you an explosion, so you know that a lot of people has bought with heavy volume, and those guys, they want to sell, they want to make their profit. When they start to sell, the movement starts to slow down, and you can see the phase 3 happening. So when you see the phase 3, you put a red line on the top, and until this red line is not broken, you can be almost sure that either the movement will go down or it will make a range. and it's what again happened after. So this is what we call a bubble, basically, a bulle in French. So when you are in a bubble, if you have enter here, when you see the phase three, you go out. But we're going to see that next time. And then this, if it's 1 hour, if you enter here in 1 hour, then the trade lasts like maybe six hours, something like that. If it's a 5 minute chart, it's few candles. Huh? If you enter here, example, 9 candles. So it could be 9 hours, it could be 9 days if it's a daily chart or this kind of thing. And sometimes it's the opposite, it's a linear. So you can see that here it starts like a bubble, so you think that it's a bubble. But finally, when you have your phase number three, so as example, some trader will close their trade here. Again, you draw your line. So here, of course, it's a support, not a resistance. But this time, what happened is that it breaks. Most of the time, when we break the level after a phase three, we have what we call a very linear movement. Because as you see after, you have a very long and slow movement that will end when we have the phase four. Voilà. And we call it a rouleau in France. Here, just a few examples again. So here you can see that you have a phase one. You know, you have the Bollinger Band, which are almost parallel. And then here you have a movement. And as you can see, the Bollinger Band, which is opposite to the movement, doesn't move. So here you can expect a movement which is very linear and a very shy start. Here you have the opposite. You have a movement which starts, and take a look, the Bollinger Band goes very high. So you might know that this is an explosion. And again, look what happened to the phase three. Exactly the end of the movement. So if you combine the phase three plus the support, plus the moving average, plus the volume, plus whatever, plus the candle, then you have a lot of signal that says, oh, maybe this is the end of this movement. Last thing with the Bollinger Band, it's a bit dark here. Remember last time I told you that me, I'm using a top and bottom using different time frames. So actually I'm using Bollinger Bands to help me to determine the trend and top and bottom. So for me, when the Bollinger Band are going up, it's an uptrend. When Bollinger Band are going down, it's a downtrend. And then I'm only doing this. Voilà. So a top for me, it's when my Bollinger Band has finished, so phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four. And again, phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four. Here there is no phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four. And every time I have a new cycle, so here I have drawn some cycle, then I have a top or a bottom. Here it's all the phase one. And sometimes you don't have phase one. So sometimes the market is very violent and goes from a phase four to a phase two. I really don't like this market. I'm very comfortable when I have violent movements. So usually when I see that, I don't really know what to do, so I don't do anything. And I prefer to wait when the market are more readable for me. So it's when we have a phase one. And then I take a time frame, for example, weekly or day one, and I will draw all the phase one that I'm seeing. So here, you can see maybe the Bollinger Band, which are parallel. So here I have a phase one. Here I have also a phase one. Here you can see several charts where I'm drawing phase one. Basically, this is my main things. I'm obsessed of phase one, because the phase one, it's when you have no movement. So if you have no movement, it means that after you have a movement. So this is only what interests me. When I'm analyzing something, I'm only looking for phase one and nothing else. And inside each phase one, so inside my white square, I'm looking at phase one that I draw here in pink. And inside my pink phase one, I'm also looking at other phase one. So I'm looking at phase one everywhere on different time frame. And I will explain you next week how this helped me. I'm finished with the Bollinger Band. Is someone have question about it? So again, no time to explain further, but go on a trading chart, you put your Bollinger Band, try to see the phase one, phase two, phase three, phase four, try to see connection and this kind of thing. Valo.
Yeah, so I'm going to speak more about the index RSI. I'm just going to need, yeah, thank you. So it's originally found by a guy called Wales Wilder, and it's a leading indicator. So basically that means that it will give you an idea and what prediction can you make of the future movement of the price based on historical data. It's also in the category of the momentum indicators, so it's very dependable from the impulse of the current market conditions. So how it's working, basically, it will give you an idea when a certain product that you're following or you're trading, it's overbought or oversold. So, which means that is it too high or too low? And what you can do when you follow this indicator, well, you can, whenever it gives you a sign that something is overbought, you can start to follow the chart and find a spot where it can sell. And whenever you see, when it gives you a sign that it's oversold, you can try to spot a place where it can buy. Everything we'll be going to discuss it later into the example. Also, here I want to mention that what it is using. Well, basically it's a line that's moving between 0 and 100. So whenever the price of a certain product is constantly increasing, the line of the RSI will move up, but that means that it's for a certain time period. So the candles that we discussed last time needs to be green, for example, if it's moving up. So every candle needs to close above the previous one. I'm telling you this because we spoke that there is a trend inside of a trend. So if we see that the RSI is giving you a sign on a daily chart, that doesn't mean that on a 1 hour chart, there is no, let's say, a downtrend, and on a daily chart, there's an uptrend. So here, for one and the same period, the RSI will give you actually different signals, and it will be in the same product as well. So commonly used techniques and combinations. Maybe it's better to discuss this while we're looking at the examples. So basically, this is the RSI. This is how it looks like. And the most commonly used techniques is that, as I mentioned you, it's moving between 0 and 100 to see when the price is above 70, this line is 70, and when it's below 30. When it's above 70, it will give you the idea that the product is overbought, and when it's below 30 here, it will give you the idea that the product is oversold. So how you can use it? Well, basically, if you see that this is the phase where the market's actually going into a range. So yeah, we can spot it like this. And the price is moving into this range, but there is nothing happening. And whenever we see that the market is giving us, actually the indicator is giving us a signal that the product is overbought, so it's between 70 and 100. As you can see here, this was the beginning of a strong downtrend. And also, I'm gonna give for this a better example later on, but here's the same. As you can see here, the RSI indicator is below 30 and between 0 and 30, so this is giving us an example that the product is oversold, so it might be a good idea to buy here. But as this is up to date, so this is tomorrow, or this is actually today, we still don't have confirmation that the price will go up, but probably it will. This is actually the oil chart. So this was some examples. Here is some more. So what I'm going to tell you here is a better example for overbought position. So actually, if you can see here, there's a strong confirmation from the RSI indicator that this is the price is too high. So this was the beginning of a strong downtrend. And here again, as you can see, this is a strong confirmation that the product is oversold and it was the beginning of an uptrend. What I actually want to mention here also, it's that sometimes, but it's really rare occasions, we can use the level around the middle, it's about 50, as a support level. So basically what it means, but that's very rare occasion, so probably you're never going to spot it, or if you spot it, it's not going to give you a strong confirmation. But as you can see, here is the range. So here the price is on a support level. We can indicate this from the RSI that it's around 50. And then it was the beginning of a new uptrend. And as you can see here, it's again overbought, and it was the beginning of a new downtrend. So here's multiple examples. If you want, actually Pascal, if you want, you can add something here about the RSI and how its movements.
Yes,
how it moves.
Just it's an indicator that is super strong, and as Valo said, it shows when the price has been oversold or overbought. And here you have in green and in red all the time that the RSI has been overbought or oversold, with the exact location on the charts. So those are not trading signals. Those are not anything but an indication that says, be careful, maybe we are at the end of a movement. And why it's super useful? Because again, as example, when you see the market going down, every time that you see a green, it's good if we can buy here, but let's be honest, it will not be possible. But it explains you that be careful, maybe the downtrend or the downtrend movement, the down movement, might be at the end. So again, it's another indication that is quite useful. So most of the time, me, I'm using this indication, or I tell people to this indication to help them to say, okay, be careful, you might be at the end of a movement. So it's time to maybe think about taking a benefit or to don't enter, this kind of thing.
And I also want to add here, I'm just going to go to the previous chart. So if the RSI indicator gives you a signal and it's combined with, if let's say here is overbought, and let's imagine this, this is here is a resistance area. So if those two are combined, this is giving you a stronger signal that it's very probable for the price to go on the opposite direction. So your idea here is to try to catch the wave on the opposite side. And again, it works on the other way as well. So if it's here and it happens to be on a support level, let's imagine there is a support level here, this is giving you two signals, actually stronger signal, that it's very probable for the price to go up.
As example, here you can see that you have a lot of, it's okay. So here you can see that you have a lot of red arrow, more red arrow actually than green arrow. It's because this is a very small time frame, maybe it's 1 hour or 30 minutes. But the big trend, so the daily one, as example, was uptrend. So when you have a big uptrend movement, you have more oversold period than overbought period, sorry, than oversold period. But what is interesting is what we're going to discuss next week. It's when you plan your strategy. So let's imagine that you have decided with your analysis that you have only to buy, and you will wait, as example, in 1 hour. Every time the RSI will be below here, you will try to find a way to buy. So let's say your analysis has said you only buy. So every time you are here, 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 there, 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 you will try to look for a trading signal.